Kia ora and welcome to the Earth Sciences New Zealand Annual Climate Summary for 2025. My name is Nava and I'm the Manager of Climate, Atmosphere and Hazards here at Earth Sciences New Zealand. This year, the summary and all of the facts and figures were meticulously compiled by climate scientist Gregor Makara. So thank you, Gregor, for doing all of the hard work. I'm just here to present it all to everyone on, that's watching online and in the room here. I'm going to go through the summary and then I'll take any questions at the end. If you have any questions, if you're watching online, please pop them in the comments and we'll try to get to them. So one of the key figures that we report on annually is our national average temperature based on the Earth Sciences New Zealand 7-station series. So this value is ranked against a temperature record extending all the way back to 1909. For 2025, the average temperature came out at 13.51 degrees Celsius, which is 0.77 degrees above average. In other words, this was our 4th-warmest year on record, and 2022 remains as our warmest year on record. 4th-warmest out of 116 years is quite a significant statistic. Unfortunately, it's not a particularly surprising one. If we take a look back at our 10 coldest years, you can see that most of them were in the early 1900s. We do have the exception of 1992 there that followed the Mount Pinatubo eruption, which caused temporary global cooling. If we take a look at our 10 warmest years on record, they're all stacked down the other end of the timeline. And this is the whole record there. You can see that the stripes do a pretty good job at highlighting how warm the last decade in particular has been. Of course, this is just our national annual average. Let's take a look at things for 2025 month by month. The year got off to a pretty cool start. January was the only month with below average temperatures for the country as a whole. There were 6 locations that experienced their coldest January on record, and a further 17 locations experienced a near record low mean temperatures. So something to keep in mind if you've been lamenting about the summer weather, last January was pretty cool. March and August observed near average temperatures. And the remaining 9 months of the year can be classified as having above average temperatures nationally. Of particular note was November. This was our warmest November on record. We also experienced our 4th-warmest July on record, our 5th-warmest April, and our 6th-warmest September on record. So despite the chillier than usual start to the year, it is the accumulation of warmth across these 9 months that we can see here that led to us having our 4th warmest year on record overall. When we look at individual weather stations across the country, there were 53 locations that observed record or near record high annual mean temperatures. And for the 10th consecutive year, there were no locations that experienced a record or near record cold year based on their annual mean temperature. This picture here shows what our rainfall looked like month by month. The green colours show where things were wetter than usual, and the brown colours indicate where areas were drier than normal. For the year as a whole, there were 4 locations in the North Island that had a near record low annual rainfall total for 2025. This includes Ngāwhi and Masterton. And in contrast, rainfall was abundant in Taupō, Blenheim and Akaroa that had a near record high rainfall for the year as a whole. When we look month by month, we can see that we had a relatively dry start to the year from January through to March. And in early March, the Minister for Agriculture classified drought conditions in Northland, Waikato, Horizons, Marlborough, Tasman. And this was a medium scale adverse event. This was an extension of the original drought classification that was made for Taranaki in February. By late April, the dry conditions had eased for most of these regions, although unusual dryness did persist for parts of Waikato until mid-May. Dryness and hot temperatures exacerbated fire weather conditions in early November. A major wildfire swept through Tongariro National Park, as can be seen here, forcing evacuations from Whakapapa Village and the nearby lodges. tracks, huts and key roads were closed as crews worked extensively to contain the blaze. And a month later, another fire broke out in the area, requiring more firefighting efforts to bring it under control. And a shout out to my earth science colleagues and Met Service colleagues who have been involved in the weather forecasting efforts for this event here to help the fire crew out. Too much rain was also an issue at times. In mid-April, right around the time that everyone was getting ready to head away for the Easter break, ex-tropical cyclone Tam travelled south and impacted much of New Zealand over the days that followed. The system was associated with a combination of strong winds, periods of heavy rain, and storm surges causing coastal erosion, with the greatest impacts being observed in Northland, Auckland, the Bay of Plenty, and the Coromandel. There were three local states of emergency declarations in 2025 due to the impacts of flooding. The first occurred from the 30th April through to the 1st of May in the Selwyn District, Christchurch and Banks Peninsula. Some residents were evacuated and multiple roads were closed. From the 26th to 27th of June, heavy rain caused widespread flooding in Nelson, Tasman and Marlborough. A state of emergency was declared for these regions. Many homes were evacuated. There were approximately 60 roads that were closed due to flooding and fallen trees. Fast forward not long later, on the 11th of July, we had heavy rain in the same area again. So major flooding in the Tasman region, putting Nelson Tasman under yet another state of emergency. There were homes that were damaged and red stickered, roads were closed, schools were closed, thousands lost power, and hundreds of people were evacuated, and some had to be rescued from floodwaters. We also had a sudden stratospheric warming event developing over Antarctica in September. This coincided with persistent and occasionally very strong west to northwesterly winds here in Aotearoa, New Zealand, from September through to December. Of particular note was a wind event at the end of October, causing widespread damage and disruption. A man was killed by a falling branch in Wellington, homes in Wairarapa lost power, and flights in and out of the capital were disrupted. There was another severe windstorm that hit the South Island. This damaged roofs and cut power to properties in Hamner Springs. In Southland and Clutha, a state of emergency was declared as wind and rain knocked out power and affected water supplies. And in Invercargill, Queen's Park was devastated, with hundreds of trees uprooted. So those were some of the major weather events of 2025. In fact, there were a lot more than that, and you can read the full annual climate summary for a few more details on that, and our monthly climate summaries have even more information about some of the extreme weather events that we've experienced in the past year. On screen now are some of our key stats for the year. So you can see that our strongest wind gust of 252 kilometres per hour was recorded during the aforementioned wind event. Our highest temperatures of the year in 2025 mostly occurred between the 7th to 8th of December. Most notably, Kawerau recorded a high of 35.6 degrees, which was the town's highest maximum temperature since records began in 1954. It is quite uncommon for New Zealand's highest temperature of the year to occur in December, and the last time this happened was in 2015. Note that 35.6 on screen, so that was our highest temperature of the year in 2025. We're probably going to exceed that in the days to come. If we take a look at some of our climate drivers for 2025, so El Niño Southern Oscillation is one of the key climate drivers for New Zealand, and that was in neutral conditions, and that prevailed throughout much of the year. However, we did transition to La Niña during October, and weak La Niña conditions continue. Throughout 2025, local sea surface temperatures stayed warmer than normal for much of the year, the exception being a brief cool spell near the western North Island in January and February. Marine heat waves were common, especially off the west coast later in the year, and these warm seas coincided with our warmer temperatures. Being a very marine nation surrounded by the water, our sea temperatures have a very big bearing on the temperatures that we experience on land. Another key climate driver is our changing climate. CO2 levels continue to rise, and they surpassed 423 parts per million at Baring Head during 2025. That's Baring Head pictured here. It's Earth Sciences New Zealand's atmospheric monitoring station, and as you can see, it's got amazing views. So in connection to our rising CO2 levels, local and global temperatures do continue to rise. The Bureau of Meteorology in Australia announced earlier this week that Australia had their 4th-warmest year on record also, and the UK Met Office announced that the UK had their warmest year on record. Globally, the announcement for the global rankings has not been made yet, but is expected to be either the second or third warmest year globally. And finally, I'd like to finish on a bit of a sunnier note. So this is our annual sunshine rankings, and this year Taranaki took out the crown for the sunniest region of the year with an annual sunshine hours total of 2,743 hours. This was recorded at our climate station in New Plymouth. In second place we had the Wairau Nelson region, and in third place Marlborough. Both of these areas, as we talked about before, experienced some significant rainfall events, so we can see why these usual top contenders for the sunshine crown maybe weren't as sunny this year.